Hello everyone, my name is Jaesuk Yang, Principal Geotechnical Engineer from Midas IT Headquarter. Today's session is on the soil structure interaction method, comparison for a bridge. For soil structure interaction, we need two groups of engineers, structure engineers and geotechnical engineers. We are going to cover different soil structure interaction methods using Midas Civil, bridge structural software, and Midas GTS NX geotechnical software. What are different approaches available and the different efficiency levels, benefits, and so on? That's an overview for the today's session. First, I will briefly walk through the soil structure interaction concept. Then, I will overview the substructure indirect method. And then, I will present about the calibration and the direct interaction method and compare the result between different soil structure interaction methods. The phenomena in which the response of soil and movement of the structure influence each other. When external force, such as earthquake, act on these systems, neither structural displacement nor ground displacement are independent of each other. Unlike an above-ground structure, the response of an underground structure subject to an earthquake is mainly controlled by the ground displacement. The ground displacement, in turn, is largely influenced by the dynamic properties of the ground and its modeling method. The ground exhibits a complete nonlinear behavior depending on the strains developed in the ground due to the dynamic load. It is therefore important to closely examine the nonlinearity of the ground relative to the strains. The substructure method is based on the principle of superposition, separating the first two causes of the interaction. The inability of the foundation to follow the pre-filled displacement and the effect of the dynamic response of the structure foundation system on the movement of the supporting soil. This method is limited to analysis of linear system or linear equivalent because it is based on the overlap. The method proceeds as follows. First, calculating the pre-filled response of the site without any embedding of the structure, analyzing the soil deposit as a dynamic subsystem. This response will be obtained in the nodes where the structure will be inserted subsequently, determining the force displacement relationship. The soil system, soil dynamic stiffness coefficient can be physically interpreted as a spring damping system. The stage corresponds to the evaluation of kinematic effects so that the structure and the foundation rock mass but heavy rigidity. In the second step, the structure supported by this spring damper system is analyzed by a load case that depends on the pre-filled movement. That stage corresponds to internal interaction, hence the mass of the structure and foundation if considered. In direct method, the soil structure system is modeled and analyzed in a single step. The excitation movement of the free field is carried at the base and at the boundaries of the model, and the result of the response of the interaction system is calculated from the equation of motion. This method requires computational program that can treat soil and structure behavior with the same rigor. For this, it is necessary a finite element program or a finite differential program. In this method, the structure can be modeled in a simplified way, but then it is necessary to remodel the structure more precisely in a second stage, where the result of the motion is applied at the base of the structure in order to determine the detailed answer. Therefore, the program used for this analysis must be compatible. Now I will overview the substructure indirect method. Structure engineers use spring to represent the soil as we see. For a given column loaded, the foundation reflects representing the soil settlements and the spring represent the soil pressure. On the other hand, geotechnical engineers model the soil as a continuum either as an elastic space or an inelastic space to determine the corresponding soil segment, soil settlement and the stress due to the column load. Determination of what the soil springs are, especially under the left. The K value, as we refer to it, which is also known as the Winkler spring or modulus of subgrade reaction, is the ratio of soil pressure over displacement. So the unit is pressure or stress over length. Now the foundation response. The significant difference between Winkler and continuum model is as below. This can be demonstrated easily by examining two extreme situations, a rigid foundation and a flexible foundation. We will see the contact pressure and the settlements between these extreme situations. For the case of the rigid left, on the left-hand side, we have the structure approach of Winkler springs model, and it's a single set of Winkler springs, which is an uniform settlement and an uniform stress distribution. However, in geotechnical approach, as you can see, the settlement may be constant, but the stress distribution is not. The high stress developing at the edges of the left. Now, by definitions of the springs at the edge of the left have to be higher than the springs at the center of the left to capture this stress behavior, while you have higher stress but the same settlement. Now, in the case of the flexible left, in the left-hand side, you have the case of the single set of spring, which gives you uniform settlements and an uniform stress distributions. However, elastic theory shows that the stress distribution under the left is going to be constant as the force that we had at the previous case, but the settlements are going to vary. The highest settlements are carrying at the center of the left and the smallest settlement carrying at the edge. Again, based on the definition of the Winkler springs, you will expect higher springs at the edge and lowest at the center. So, what is the solution for this? The solution is that we should not use one zone of springs, but at least two zones with the outermost springs being higher than the springs at the center. Now, for steep soil, outer springs may increase from 30 to 40% compared to the springs at the center, whereas at the soft soil, we will have to increase 2 or 3 times compared to the springs in the center. Again, the steep soil and the soft soil is relative to the foundation stiffness and the loading, and even rock would need to use two zones of springs. Different method to determine the K value, also known as modulus of subgrade reaction. Method A consists of plate load test. You calculate the values from the test stated in your textbook. They are not appropriate for the left design because they only apply to the areas at 1 foot by 1 foot scale. Method B consists of taking the same values and is a crude method. The most appropriate method is method C, where you will model the loaded foundation probably with finite element. Now for method C, You could do that. Each geotechnical engineer will estimate the settlement and bearing pressure at many points within the left, and they will determine many K value based of the pressure of settlement designs, and they will draw contours of the K value and determine accordingly what kind of zones to assign and what kind of K value assign to those zones. This is the method that most structural engineers are most familiar with, either using a finite element analysis software or a simpler design software. For most cases, structural engineers reflect the soil and soil structure interaction using soil spring data. There are largely two ways for the indirect method too. Handling the substructure apart from the superstructure, with the superstructure information reflecting using the load or boundary conditions applied to the top of the substructure. Second, handling the entire structure together, meaning superstructure and substructure together. The first, the substructure only approach, is the common approach taken from a design software such as RCPier, LPier, and FEPier. However, when we have to consider the soil structure interaction, it may affect the superstructure as well. Therefore, we have to understand that with this substructure only approach, we are working with broken components for the whole system in reality, especially if we are dealing with seismic analysis. The second, the entire structure together approach, is more common and more accurate approach take if an engineer is using an analysis tool such as Midas, Civil, and so on. The second model bridges with the all of the structure and substructure and superstructure together can be time saving if any engineer would like to perform direct interaction check, which I will introduce today. It is because this whole bridge model and data can be transferred to Midas Geotechnical Software, GTS NX. We will get to the direct analysis in a little bit. This is an example bridge used to compare and calibrate the result with the direct approach. Previously, I mentioned this approach. Modeling the entire structure is something common if an engineer is using an analysis tool such as Midas Civil and so on. In Midas, you can actually use the automatic soil spring data generator function, which allow you to get the initial spring data based on basic soil parameters. This is the result in Midas Civil using PY springs, axial force, bending moment, and shear force, displacement. Now I will present about the calibration and the direct interaction method and compare the result between the different SSI method. File depth and their bearing behavior is a very good example for soil structure interaction. If we have a look here on the left side, we have a left spread from the piles, so the left itself has its own interactions with the soil around it, and the file has interaction with the soil around it. And there is interaction between the file, the left, and the files themselves, which is a little bit summarized here on the right side. These four arrows showing the interaction. We have file soil interaction, we have left soil interaction, we have left files interaction, and we have file interaction here. These interactions are very critical governing how the file left will behave or perform and its bearing capacity at the end. The total bearing capacity of the file left will be the summation of the bearing capacity of the files plus the bearing capacity of the file left. And the file bearing capacity is in itself the summation of the base capacity plus the shaft capacity. The left bearing capacity is at the contact stress over the area of the left. And this total bearing capacity combined by a left should be larger than the applied loads multiplied by the factor of safety. Applied model should be able to consider the different interaction that govern the behavior of the file left, which we just saw in the slides. The workflow typically to model file left will start by creating the numerical model and filling this numerical model by input parameters from geotech reports, from lab testing and field testing, and also from file load testing. So you probably will create a single file model, calibrate parameters for this file model, and this will be using for feeding your final of your numerical model of the complete file left. You are on your simulation and you will get result and terms of deformation, stress and strains, force in the files, and you can also time refer parametric study, so variation of the layout of the file, the diameter and the length, and properties, and also different load combinations. If you have different combination, refer to structural load, wind load, earthquake load, and combination of these. And at the end, you always end up with a set of structure parameters that you come up with. And if you do the separate structural design, most of the time, you hand this to the structural engineer to use it for structural design of the superstructure. And there are always interaction between superstructure engineers. You will go back and modify your model a little bit. So this is a typical flow chart for the numerical analysis for file left foundation to enable structural design. So to quickly determine the iterative process between the structural engineer and geotechnical engineer, the structural engineer provides the column rows to the geotechnical engineer who has already developed and modeled of the foundation and the soil, and the geotechnical engineer evaluates the foundation settlement and the stress and provides the structural engineer with winkler springs or soil springs. Then structural engineer runs after their model, and they determine the foundation settlement and the stress under the left. They compare with the geotechnical engineer, and either they are closing off or the geotechnical engineer needs to revise the springs and come up with the new foundation settlements and stresses. This process keeps up until the settlement between the structural model and geotechnical model are closing up. When we come to GTS-NX, we can model files with three different approaches. Actually, in general, in 3D numerical tool, you should be able to model your file as a volume element, and you should have proper interface around it to be able to capture this interaction between the file and the soil properly. So this is a basic ingredient you should have. In GTS-NX, we can do that. We can model the file as a full volume element, solid element model with an interface around. When you have large number of files, it can be computationally intensive. So you can think of an alternative, and one alternative to use beams representing the files with the interface around it also. Or you can use something like we have here in GTSNX, embedded file or file element, which is a line to solid, which is a beam element connected through a line to solid interface to the surrounding soil. You look close to each of these elements. So if you look here at the soil model, we imagine here we have a file inserted in the soil. File itself is modeled with solid element, which is a volume element, filled by its full diameter and length of course. And next to the file itself, we have 2D interface surrounding it to be able to model the soil structure interaction. We have the solid for the soil, solid for the file, and we have interface connecting a file to the soil. To such a model, we have to ensure that you have nodal connectivity along the whole surface of the file and surrounding soil and the interface as well. That means that you also have to think about refinement around the file to be able to capture the stress equalization that may happen if you have some failure. So, if we have a large model with large number of files, that becomes a huge model computationally, takes a lot of time, even with the hardware development nowadays. Points of attention for solid element models. Now we are looking at the file left application, not a single file nor a small number of files and a file group. This you can definitely use solid element, but when we look at file wrapped analysis, then we can think of model definition and mesh generation could be elaborated for large number of files. You end up having many elements in your model, which means large computation times. File force and moments are not directly available in post-processing. That is partly not necessary in GTSNX, that you can have composite element where GTSNX will calculate the force in the solid for you. So you still use the solid element typically when you use volume element and solid element. You only get stress and strains and not force. But in GTSNX, you have possibility to use composite element to extract this force. In other numerical tools and other programs, I'm not sure if it has this feature. In general, we can say that file force are not directly available in post-processing using solid element. So you have to use some tricks to extract this or integrate your stress and strains to get your force. The interface behavior that we have is elastic, nonlinear elastic, Coulomb friction, and user-supplied material. So in terms of interface, there should not be a problem. Other possibility is to use beam solid connectivity model, and here you will have solid representing soil, and for the file, instead of using solid element, you will use a beam element. Here we have only cross-section showing, so this is for visualization only, but the file itself is actually modeled with the beam element, 1D element I mean. This beam element is fully connected to the soil around. We have to have fully compatible of or full nodal connectivity between this beam element and surrounding soil. And you can have an interface, so 1D interface connecting this beam element to the surrounding soil. So again, the nodal connectivity still has to be ensured. The nodal compatibility requirement makes geometry modeling and meshing of the soil elaborative. You will have less number of elements because all the three file elements become 1D and for file left with large number of files. This technique produces large models, and you still have to ensure this compatibility. On the other hand, you will have force and moments in your file as output immediately. So this is another option. The third option we have is to use this embedded file or file element. And in embedded file, you don't need to worry about the nodal connectivity between the file itself and the surrounding soil. So you can model your soil completely independent of the files, and the files themselves can be placed arbitrarily in these soils going through the solid element. The beam element that represents the file will be connected to the surrounding soil through a special interface. Actually, two interfaces. One is line to solid interface for the shaft, which is in itself two parts. One part is connected to the beam. One part here, I light in red, red connected to the hosting 3D soil element. Here, I have to mention of this idea having embedded file technique goes back to the beginning of 2004. There was a publication by Sadek and Sauer. They had a word on 3D embedded beam element for reinforced geomaterials. It was meant for reinforcement like anchors and things like that, and this was utilized here as a file element. So there was some modification, mainly addition of the interface and the tip interface and the tip element to become a file element. Here shows the line to interface, line to solid elements for this beam to solid connection, and you can see here that can be used with the different types of element. We have hexahedral, pentahedron, and tetrahedron, and the file we go arbitrarily through the element, and the GTS NX will automatically create or calculate this intersection between the file element and the hosting soil element. The soil element can be linear or could be quadratic as well. The main idea of here is that any of these solid element displacement field is known where inside the element. The declaration function will allow you to calculate the this space anywhere in the element. And once the interaction position is known, the displacement at the nodes of these files intersecting soil elements can be calculated. The same goes for the interfacing between the hosting element and the beam element of line to solid interface. Characteristic of line to solid interface that the file and soil geometry and meshes can be specified independently, so you don't need to worry about messing them and having nodal connectivity. The intersection applied solid elements are calculated automatically. You can assign nonlinear friction slip properties for the line to solid interface element, and I'll explain that just in a few slides next. Mesh refinement requirements for the soil are minimum. So we have reduced computation time. This is really well suited for file left type analysis. Next to the shaft, we have a similar element, spring, nonlinear spring at the top, at the tip. So the tip again can be arbitrarily placed on part of any part of the hosting solid soil element. And you can have an interface point to solid interface in this case, describing the relative behavior between the soil and the file tip. This table is a comparison of three approaches for shaft friction. And this table is a comparison of three approaches for special file tip capacity. For automatic creation of line to solid interface element in GTSNX, after meshing file lines with a single beam element for file, use the file tip menu and create a property for the file-soil interface behavior, and then define file-soil friction properties and file deep bearing capacities. In terms of input parameters, these interface between embedded file of the beam and the soil are characterized by few parameters. In principle, you have a set of springs at the shear between the beam and the soil, and these springs are two in lateral direction, so Ks, Kn, and Kt, and one along the file axis, which is Ks. The next to the stiffness, there is an ultimate shear force. Actually, the bearing capacity in this case is a sort of an input. So you determine ultimate shear force for the skin friction and also for the base capacity as an input of your model. You will not be able to calculate the failure behavior of your files. So this is really well suited for deformation behavior and the serviceability limit state. So this ultimate shear force, you need to get it from, if you have a file loading test from the curve, you can separate the shaft friction from the base and the base from the total load deformation behavior and assess your ultimate shear force for skin friction. Stiffness are actually linear elastic penalty stiffness, so they can be assigned as a high value of stiffness, and you only need to ensure that in the shown elastic part, if we look here at the graph on the left side, which describes shaft friction force in relation to the relative slip displacement between the file and the soil. We see that this elastic part until we reach the ultimate shear force. The stiffness have to ensure that you don't have to behavior of the interaction, or this interface doesn't cover the total behavior, so you should get your elastic behavior more from the soil surrounding until you reach your limit shear force that you have specified. So you have Ks, elastic linear penalty stiffness, along the file describing the skin friction, and you have two penalty stiffness in the transversal direction. These types of files are designed in principle for axial loading. This is why you see the ultimate shear force and the Ks and the longitudinal direction, axial direction of file. However, in the lateral direction, there is nothing preventing that you can also apply at lateral load. However, there is no limiting force in the lateral direction. That means maximum or limiting lateral capacity will come from the soil itself and not from the file interaction. So if we look more closely, here we will represent this solid black line of the beam element, and around there is the interface. We have the Kn and Kt, which are lateral stiffness, and we have the Ks along the longitudinal direction. The traction are related to the stiffness, so the Ts, Tn, and Tt are value, so they equal to the Qs, which is shear force divided by the length. That means that it equals to the Ks, which is the stiffness to input multiplied by its relative displacement between the soil and the file, and these are in the different direction. The Ts, which is the axial traction, and the shear traction should be less or equal to the Q ultimate that has been input in your model. The same goes for the base or the tip bearing capacity. You have the QB, which equals to the KB, which is the base stiffness multiplied by the delta U, and this has to be less or equal to the QB ultimate, which is a value for tip bearing capacity input, again, for your model. Although you have all these springs by linear relation. You still, because we have so many points of so many springs along the whole length, and we have interaction between this beam and the soil surrounding it, you end up having high linear curve describing force displacement behavior of the single file. This graph is also covering both positive and negative directions. When you input this relation, GTS NX actually describing the full graph in the plus and the minus will allow you to capture both positive and negative skin friction. So, if you have part of the file and the behavior was negative skin friction, you can still capture that in this relation. So, these are the input of the interface of the file. The traction are actually output of your analysis. Next to that, we have file beam properties, which are cross-section properties, material properties, and length. For example, you can choose from a library of cross-section the shape of file and input the dimension, and it will calculate section properties for you. We did validation for this. When it was introduced to GTS NX, and we tried to re-simulate one of the examples where there have been extensive monitoring these days, and all example is file of the all the highway bridge in German, those presented by El Muslim in 1999. It shows the full file load deformation behavior, the total load, skin friction, and the base load. And we have simulated the exact same file behavior, so the file is actually 1.3 meter diameter file and 9.5 meter length. We have simulated this using embedded file technique, and we are satisfied with the behavior we could capture, the total load behavior, skin friction, and the base resistance. We can say that we can capture in a reasonable way as an individual component. So that was satisfactory. Next, I would like to mention about the compatibility of the program with other software products. Engineers who have their project drawn on CAD often find that they need to redraw their entire project in the analysis software when they come to the point of modeling and analyzing their design. GTS NX enables you to import your CAD drawings directly into the program. This feature compatibly eliminates the need to recreate existing drawings in the program, thus saving us considerable amounts of time and effort. Once the geometry is imported, there is a variety of different tools to fix geometry shapes. For example, where we have gaps between edges that should be connected, GTS NX will remove this small surface and make the connection. Furthermore, GTS NX can import model information such as geometry, element information, and a structural cross section from others by the software, Gen or Civil. The CAD interface transfers project data for expanded analysis, requiring soil structure interaction and detailed 3D investigation such as bridge pier and tall building foundations. The model information and the loading boundary condition analysis data from the Midas Gen Civil program or the Midas family program can be synchronized on the GTS NX. Element types, load boundary conditions, analysis method not supported on the GTS NX are excluded. The compatibility range for Midas MST files is shown below. This is the example application from Midas Gen building structure into GTS NX. And Yeah, this is the on your left side. The model shows the from Midas Civil, and with MXT format, you can import the bridge structure into GTSNX, and you will proceed your geometry modeling for the ground, the meshing. Then you can check the result, the whole substructure as well as the superstructure after analysis in GTSNX. The another bridge application, import the structure itself into GTSNX. From now on, I will demonstrate using Midas software. So this is the Midas Civil. So firstly, I will open the bridge model. So as you can see, once you have model this bridge in using Midas Civil, as well as the meshing, for example, you already define the material property and section property as well. And also, once you have load or boundary condition here, you can export with the MXT format. So save as, save with MXT format file. Then this kind of text file will be created with the MXT format, which contains the mesh material and property and load or boundary condition as well. So this text file can be used import into GTSNX. So this is the GTSNX. So import Midas MXT. So let's open the MXT file, which was saved in the Midas Civil. So as you can see, you can import the Midas Civil model directly in GTSNX. So when you check the material and the property, and the load. So I mean, once you have created this kind of information in Midas Civil, you can import into GTSNX using MXT format. And then you can proceed your geometry modeling for ground in GTSNX. So you can start with the solid geometry for the 3D ground. And then using this geometry solid, you will create the meshing. And then you can check the result in GTSNX. So after importing this MXT file from Midas Civil, then as I mentioned, you can create this geometry and for soil, and after that you will create the ground meshing using this solid. So this is the geometry creating in GTSNX using this solid. Finally, this is the final model. For numerical analysis in GTSNX. So after defining the construction stage, This model has the result for the construction. So it consists of four construction. So for example, this is the initial phase, people construction, and install construct the foundation with file, and construct bridge, and with load. So for your information, you can also show the section of this bridge structure once you have defined this in the section library from Midas Civil. Okay, and when you check the result, you can check the displacement of the ground. This is the final stage result. So initial phase, total displacement, and install the structure, and finally the bridge itself has been struck. And also you can check the result of the structure itself, the axial force, the shear force, and the bending moment. So this is the result for bridge itself from imported model into GTSNX. And we compare with the more updated substructure. When we compare the result between two programs, it has to be modified using the updated substructure. So this is the conclusion. Midas Civil has internal PY curves in order to easily apply soil springs and learn soil structure interaction through substructure method. For some soils, this is sufficient. Substructure method cannot accurately capture the nonlinear behavior experienced by the foundation and the surrounding ground during an earthquake. Midas GTS NX can import full structure from Midas Civil to learn soil structure interaction through direct method. However, since the ground is modeled in 3D, it must first be calibrated through comparison of ground response analysis like prefilled and linear equivalent. Also, this feature we support in Midas GTS NX. Thank you.